Okay, well, welcome back to the program. Please have a seat. Stepping aside from the technical provisions of Section 367D, as Professor Steinus had explored for us, through which one must navigate when transferring intangibles outside the United States, now let's take a step back and focus on some of the practical or structural considerations with respect to intangible property planning. Tom Zollo, who's an international tax principal with KPMG's Washington National Tax Practice, is going to illustrate various supply chain structures that are commonly used by multinationals in the context of business restructurings, where added benefits can be achieved through effective tax planning concerning the legal and economic ownership of intangible properties. Tom is a frequent speaker and author on international tax topics and is an adjunct professor at Chicago Kent College of Law. Tom?
Okay, thanks, Larry. I'm tempted to use my half hour not to talk about supply chain, but rather about 367D, because I found that so provocative. But I will not. I'll resist that temptation. And I'm going to talk less about supply chain and just more about IP holding company structures that are used in connection with supply chain planning. But, you know, let's, you know, for a minute, step back from the tax world and think about supply chain. And imagine that you are the CEO of a company, you've just been brought in, and you have European operations that maybe have manufacturing in half a dozen countries and distribution in 30 or so countries. And you have to think about, you know, what is the most efficient way to run this enterprise? Well, you know, would it be sensible to allow each local country entity to run its manufacturing however it wants, and then find a market for those products? Well, you know, of course not, right? You're going to want to come up with some kind of supply forecast for the region. You're going to want to allocate production among your various factories in a way that makes the most sense, that is most efficient, and, you know, take the products to market in all 30 countries in a way that makes sense. So, you know, what you want to do is to reduce your investment in inventory, you want to reduce your accounts receivable, all those good kinds of things. What that implies is that you're really going to have centralized management. And when I go around to companies, in fact, that's what they do, right? They run according to regions. So somebody will be the managing person in charge of the EMEA region, and he's responsible for managing the supply chain. And when you're doing that, what do? Do you leave procurement in each factory? No. You want to leverage the efficiencies and size of the whole organization. You want to reduce redundancies. So you tend to centralize those functions. And it perhaps is not unreasonable, if you're centralizing functions in a particular jurisdiction, to look at one that satisfies a couple criteria. First, it has to be a place where your management wants to live. Second, once you've satisfied that, it ought to be a place that has a low tax rate. Because all things being equal, you'd prefer to have a low tax rate. So it's not surprising that we find structures that are built around countries like Ireland and Switzerland, although, as we'll see, you know, there can also be structures that are built around countries that have more normal tax rates. I'd also say that in the system that I've set out, it doesn't make sense to have every entity be a fully at-risk entrepreneur, because the truth is they aren't responsible for entrepreneurial decisions. You've centralized your decisions as to where you're going to manufacture products, how much you're going to manufacture in each location. So truthfully, you aren't giving your manufacturing entities the freedom to be real entrepreneurs. They aren't in competition with each other. Instead, they're taking direction from the center. So the typical supply chain system, even forgetting about tax for a minute, would be one where you have kind of centralized ownership of the region, and various manufacturers and distributors that have relatively less risk and therefore less opportunity to make losses. Okay, so the typical supply chain structure is set up in a way that recognizes these basic economics. And typically you would have a CFC principle, which, you know, it's easy to think of Ireland or Switzerland in my European example as being the principal entity. That's where your management is going to sit. That's where you're going to formulate your supply forecast. That's where you're going to allocate where manufacturing is done and so on. And then you will have contract manufacturing with the manufacturers that have been largely de-risked contractually. You are hopefully making a substantial contribution to that manufacturing so that when the principal buys those goods and resells them, it's treated as a manufacturer under the Section 954 regulations. And then it sells to limited risk distributors. Now, what this means practically is that there is limited risk of the manufacturers and distributors making losses. Now, of course, they can make losses. If you have a downturn in demand, the manufacturers may not be fully utilized. They may have capacity costs that throw them into a loss. Distributors, if they're doing crazy things, may also end up in a loss. But you would think that as a general matter, your manufacturers and distributors are not going to make losses. What that does is it leaves the entrepreneurial risk with your low tax principal. Now, it may also make losses, although it benefits from a couple things. One is that it has the portfolio of the whole region. So whereas a particular country may be off in a period, it's less likely that the whole region is off. And while the whole region may be off for a short period of time, if you're making losses for a long period of time, obviously you're going to go out of business. So you'd think that the principal in the long run ought to be earning some premium for the risk that it has undertaken. Now, there's some suggestion, and I'll get to some of the suggestion that's appeared in the press later on, that these structures are somewhat nefarious. And I would submit that they're built off three principles that everybody in this room is familiar with. The first is the concept of check the box. We have the ability, except with respect to per se entities, to elect whether we want an entity to be treated as a flow through or disregarded or treated as a CFC. It's been in the law for 15 years. It's the stock and trade of every tax advisor. The second principle is one I just talked about, which is the contract manufacturing regulations. We know that the principal does not actually have to do physical manufacturing. What it needs to do is to make a substantial contribution to manufacturing under regulations that went through a proposed phase. People commented on them. A portion of them were temporary. They then went final. So there's no mystery to anybody in this room or indeed to the government about the way those rules are intended to operate. And then the third feature, similarly, there's not much confusion about, and that's the cost-sharing regulations, or more broadly, the 482 regulations, including the rules for licensing under Dash 4. Those have been the subject of exhaustive regulations, new regulations, proposed regulations, temporary regulations, comment, until it's, we're all blue in the face on it. So those three elements are the building blocks of every structure I'm going to talk about, and they are well-known, tried and true. The branch rules may be impenetrable. Those of us in practice have to penetrate them and render advice based on what they say. Now, when you're focusing on the IP alternatives, essentially there are three different alternatives, and I think it's worth thinking about them over the course of time. And the previous speakers have talked about this somewhat. First, you could simply have the United States fund the worldwide R&D, own the IP, and license the IP that the principal needs to the principal for use in its region. Okay? A second approach is to have a cost-sharing arrangement. So what the principal will do is it will share costs with the United States based upon the reasonably anticipated benefits inside and outside their regions, and they'll own the IP that they need for those operations. Again, this has been the subject of all the various iterations of the 482-7 regulations through the years. And in connection with that, you have the great issue of what kind of PCT payments or buy-in payments need to be made for existing intangibles. Now, you might bravely go the route of having a non-qualified cost-sharing arrangement rather than a qualified cost-sharing arrangement under Dash 7. If you do that, you're just under the regular rules under Dash 4 and elsewhere in the 482 regulations on how to determine whether the dealings are arm's length. There are various factors that would go into whether you want to have a qualified arrangement or non-qualified that I won't go into here. And then finally, there is one way to get IP offshore on a tax-deferred, if not tax-free, basis currently, and that's to make the contribution to a foreign partnership, a Section 721 transaction, rather than dealing with a CFC. So you don't need to worry about having a taxable transaction under Section 482 or having a transaction that is covered by 367D. Okay, so what are some of the structures? First, 10 or 15 years ago, I think a very common structure was simply to have the United States fund the worldwide R&D effort, so it would pay various affiliates that performed R&D on a cost-plus basis. It would own the worldwide IP rights, and it would license those rights to CFCs. And in this kind of structure, it would license them to a CFC principal. And I have clients that still do that. Now, you know, what's the advantage of this? Well, normally the royalty flow back to the United States has a very low tax rate attached to it, because under many treaties, there's going to be no withholding on the royalties or withholding at a very low rate. And so when you had a situation where foreign rates were as high or higher than the US rate, and you went through the various rules for allocating deductions against foreign source income, many US multinationals were in an excess foreign tax credit position. So getting a reliable flow of low tax foreign source income was a great thing. You brought it back, it increased your limitation, you used all those foreign tax credits that you otherwise couldn't utilize. And it was an efficient structure in the sense that you've now focused your transfer pricing risk, right? The IRS is going to come in on an annual basis and ask whether the royalty flow is adequate, but that's really the risk that you have. And I think, you know, that this was a predominant structure for a long time. Now, more recently, we've come up with structures that are based on cost sharing. And why is that? Well, fewer companies find themselves in an excess foreign tax credit position. It would be much better to get the IP-related income into a lower taxed environment. And so it makes more sense to split the development risk between the United States and the foreign participant, have the foreign participant own the foreign rights, and earn the benefits that accrue from having funded the IP. Now, here's where some of the fun comes in. And I've started with the Dutch sandwich structure just because it has kind of a nice, funny name. People who aren't in the tax world look at it and they ask, what is this? It sounds like it's something fishy. But as I said, you know, it really just fits together what we've been talking about. First, it's based on your traditional cost sharing, right? We're going to have an offshore IP owner that is sharing the cost of development going forward. It also relies on check the box. Okay, so what we want to have is a foreign principal. And in the typical Dutch sandwich structure, what we have is an Irish operation. So we're going to have an Irish resident company, which is where our management sits. Those are the people who are making a substantial contribution to manufacturing in the region. And if we just had the cost-sharing arrangement with Ireland, Ireland would tax all the profits there at a 12.5% rate, which is a pretty good rate, right? It's better than the US rate. But here's where we get some instruction about tax arbitrage and, you know, the way people think, which is 12.5% is nice, but 0% is even nicer. So is there a way that we can get the IP profits into a zero-taxed environment? And the answer is yes, we can via check the box and the way that various foreign country rules work. So if you set up an Irish incorporated entity, it is only subject to Irish tax to the extent that it's managed and controlled in Ireland. If it's actually managed and controlled elsewhere, Ireland won't treat it as Irish. They'll treat it as a resident in the foreign state. So in this type structure, we would set up a top-tier entity, which is going to be my IP owner funder under the cost-sharing arrangement. And we're going to have it managed and controlled out of Bermuda. Now, the United States regards that as an Irish incorporated entity. As I said, we're going to have an Irish resident company, which is where my management sits, and that's underneath my Irish incorporated Bermuda resident entity, and we're going to check the box to have that be disregarded. Okay, so far, so good. That's the entity that, by the way, ultimately needs the IP to use in its operations. Now, we could simply license the IP directly from our Bermuda resident entity to the Irish entity, but the problem is that, depending upon the sort of IP we're talking about, Ireland might impose a withholding tax on that royalty payment. Well, we'd certainly like to get rid of that, so we look around and we find that the Netherlands does not impose a withholding tax on royalties. We also know that since Ireland and the Netherlands are both countries in the European Union, that we can pay royalties from our Irish resident company to our Dutch company without any withholding tax. So we go to the Dutch tax authorities, and they agree that if our Dutch entity, the BV at the bottom, licenses the IP from the Bermuda resident company, and then on licenses to our Irish resident company, and keeps a small spread, which the Netherlands can tax at a 25.5% rate, that the Netherlands will be happy with that, and they won't impose any withholding tax on the main royalty that's paid back to Bermuda. So in this kind of structure, I've pulled the IP-related income out of Ireland, and that's 12.5% tax rate. I've left a tiny sliver in the Netherlands, but if my IP is generating high profits, I've pulled a nice royalty into Bermuda with a 0% tax rate. Okay, so that's the basic Dutch sandwich. And as I said, it's based on check the box. It's based on arm's length pricing for the cost sharing arrangement. And there's nothing much more to it than that. Well, the Irish have kind of cut out the Dutch largely. 2 years ago, they came up with some rules that said that if you have patented IP where it was developed outside Ireland and is originally registered outside Ireland, the Irish authorities will actually give you a ruling that says no withholding tax. So you could have the same structure I just described, but just cut out the Dutch entity, have a simple license from our Bermuda resident Irish incorporated entity to the Irish operating company. And I've called that the double Irish structure. Now, you know, interestingly here, we're not dealing with anybody's CFC rules because all the United States sees, of course, is a single Irish CFC. And the main portion of subpart F we'd be worried about is the 954D, the foreign-based company sales rules. And we've dealt with that because we have sufficient substance in Ireland to make a substantial contribution to manufacturing. In the next structure, we take advantage of the fact that Switzerland does not have any CFC rules. And it works very much like my double Irish structure. So we've put our management in Switzerland. The Swiss are responsible for managing the EMEA business. And, you know, but we aren't happy with the rate that we got in Switzerland. You know, we have a ruling that gives us an 8% or a 10% tax rate. But again, we're willing to arbitrage to take substantial profits out and get them at a 0% tax rate. So the magic here is we put an entity underneath the Swiss entity, our IP holdco, and that's going to be the participant in the cost-sharing arrangement. It will fund ongoing R&D, and it will strip income out of Switzerland by having royalties paid by the Swiss principal down to it. And, you know, interestingly, that may be a Bermuda company or a Cayman entity. It actually could be a U.S. LLC, because to the extent that it's not engaged in a U.S. trade or business, and it's getting royalties that are not from U.S. sources, it's not going to be subject to U.S. taxation on that. And, you know, Switzerland will allow the deduction but not tax the profits under any kind of subpart F rules, and in fact will allow participation exemption if the cash gets remitted back up to Switzerland. The United States, again, just sees a Swiss CFC in this circumstance, and as long as we're making a substantial contribution from our Swiss offices, everything is hunky-dory. Probably a term I should have used in connection with Ireland rather than Switzerland, but everything is okay under this structure. Now let's suppose, for some reason, management does not want to go to Ireland or Switzerland. They prefer to live in a place like the UK or the Netherlands. Well, you can accommodate that. And again, it's check the box that allows us to do that. And in this structure, I've just illustrated it with the common CV-BV structure. CV is a contractual arrangement that's transparent from a Dutch perspective. I haven't indicated who the second party is, probably a second member of the US group here. Maybe it's a disregarded LLC. But we've checked the CV closed to treat it as a corporation from a US perspective. It's going to be the participant in the cost-sharing arrangement. The Netherlands isn't going to tax any profits that are earned by the CV because it's not doing anything in the Netherlands. It's simply cost-sharing with the US in my example. But it is licensing in to the Dutch operating company, which is the entity that actually houses the Dutch management that is responsible for overseeing manufacturing in the European region. And again, there's a royalty that's paid. Under Dutch law, there's no withholding tax on royalty payments. So we get a strip out of the Netherlands where the profits would otherwise be taxed at a 25.5% rate, and we move them into our zero taxed environment. Now, you know, I could go on and on with these, right? There are countless, you know, innumerable examples of how these structures work, all based on the cost sharing regs, the contract manufacturing regs, and check the box. So, I'll stop here and just say that there has been a slight movement away from these, or people are viewing them as less desirable. And it's not really because of the Obama proposals, I think. It's more because they look at the way that the cost-sharing regulations have tightened through the years. They look at the way that the IRS approaches cost-sharing, and they say, well, if we are a mature company that has a current generation of IP that is going to contribute to future generations of IP, you know, we think that the cost of getting into the structure is too high. We aren't willing to have negative tax drag for 2 or 3 years waiting to get into the situation where this kind of structure then makes sense. And we have no way of sheltering the income that we're going to receive from the buy-in payment. Okay, that leads to the last structure that I want to spend some time on, which I think is being considered more frequently now. And that is the use of a foreign partnership. And that foreign partnership may itself be your principal operation. It may house the executives who are making a substantial contribution to manufacturing. You know, it may be a Swiss entity that you've checked to be a partnership. And typically in this arrangement, it would have a CFC partner, which maybe is an existing Swiss company, and the US parent. And the US parent, let's assume, owns all of the group's IP. So you started out in the first situation I described where the US has long funded all of the group's IP development and owns the IP. Well, the US parent will make a contribution to the partnership by contributing that IP. The CFC partner, if it has IP, may put that in, but it will also put in personnel and it may contribute other operations. Perhaps it owns the manufacturing and distribution companies in Europe and it puts those down into the partnership. And the point of this partnership is it's going to run the European business going forward. Okay. Now, all the nasty things we heard about 367D and its limits don't apply, because although Section 367D permits Treasury to extend the rules of 367D to partnerships, that has not been done. Okay, so what we have here is just the application of the normal partnership contribution rules under Section 721. And what that requires is that US parent, when it puts down the IP, take back an interest in the partnership that is equal in value to what it put in. So it's going to book a capital account that's equal in value to the IP that it put in. Now, one question might be, do we avoid transfer pricing altogether on this? And the answer is no. This is an exchange, right? And Section 482 does apply to exchanges between related parties. Certainly our CFC and the foreign partnership and the US parent are all related to each other. So we still need to value the IP that's going in and make sure that the United States is taking back a partnership interest that is equal in value to an arm's length price for the IP. Do we avoid US tax? Well, the answer to that is not directly, because partnerships, unlike controlled foreign corporations, are not, their profits are not eligible for deferral, right? They get allocated out to the partners based upon their respective partnership interests. Now, what this does allow us to do is to come up with partnership allocations, and as long as we've complied with Section 704B and 704C, we can use the flexibility of partnership special allocations to determine who gets what. And there are a couple different flavors of this IP partnership. One would be to give the U.S. A preferred but limited interest for the bulk of the value that it's putting down. But another approach might be to say, well, the U.S. is putting down IP that, if the U.S. had just held on to it, would have produced income with a very low foreign tax rate attached to it and would have just increased the U.S. excess limitation position for foreign tax credit purposes. Instead, we're going to use this as a kind of mixing bowl, and we'll have the U.S. take back disproportionately a share of profits from our manufacturers and distributors. Well, we know that the manufacturing is likely done in normal tax jurisdictions like Germany, France, Italy, and that the distribution is taking place largely in countries where people with money are. So again, Germany, France, Italy, right? And by taking back those special allocations, what we've done is we've swapped what would have been low-taxed foreign source income for relatively higher-taxed foreign source income. So on that basis, the residual taxation in the United States is reduced. So along a continuum, we've gone from U.S. as the single owner and licensing out to the cost-sharing to this kind of arrangement. And I would suggest that this progression has largely been caused by the difference between the U.S. tax rate, on corporations and foreign tax rates. Because in the situation where U.S. corporations are in an excess credit position, that original structure worked just fine. It's only when foreign rates went down significantly relative to U.S. rates that it was no longer fine to bring back low tax royalties on a general basis. And so companies looked for these other structures as a way to optimize their tax position. Okay. Now, you know, there is a problem of perception. And a couple years ago, it was December 28th, actually, 2010, I was sitting in my home office and I hear my wife, who's off reading the newspaper while drinking her morning coffee, chuckle. And she said, "Is there really such a thing as a Dutch sandwich?" And I said, "Yes, you know, there is such a thing as the Dutch sandwich." And I basically drew out for her that first slide that we started with. And she said, "Well, Dilbert has picked up on it today." And you know, I think Manal's going to be here later on to talk, and I was talking to Manal informally a couple years ago, and I told her about this. She said, "Well, whenever something appears in the popular press to do with taxes, that's when I'm going to get a call from the White House." And I was trying to imagine President Obama reading Dilbert, and I couldn't. But then I imagined Vice President Biden looking at the paper on his way, you know, down from Delaware to Washington. I thought, well, maybe this will catch their attention. But you know you have a problem when something appears in Dilbert, right? There's going to be a problem in perception that something is being done wrong. And I'm going to use the remainder of my time to talk about the excess return proposal, largely because I'm going to be debating, and I can use this as an unfair advantage to just kind of set up the debate in a way that's advantageous to my side. But you know, we've talked about this excess return proposal. And largely, the excess return proposal is, you know, based on the notion that there's something nefarious going on here and we need to put an end to it. And it has three requirements for its application. The first is there has to be a transfer of intangible property from the United States to a CFC. Let's stop there for a minute. A United States parent almost always is going to transfer some intangibles to its CFCs, right? We know that Section 936H3B lists 28 specific items in what are considered to be intangibles. And those include things like the brand name, you know, trade name, trademarks. It includes contracts. So if, for example, the United States has negotiated a global supply contract and it allows a CFC to pull down on that contract, arguably, it's made a transfer of intangibles. Certainly, if it requires the foreign subsidiaries to use the U.S. brands, it's transferred an intangible. So I think, you know, you'd be hard-pressed to ever get comfortable if you're advising someone that your CFCs have not received some intangible from the United States that in some way touches the products that we're selling through our supply chain. So that's a requirement that is really a non-requirement, right? It's a peppercorn. The second requirement is that the CFC has to earn excess income from an activity in which the intangible is used. Now, you know, go back to my example. It may be that you acquired the foreign group. The foreign group may have been an extremely successful independent company. It may have developed its own patents and products, right, processes. But now it's required by the U.S. parent to slap the U.S. trade name on its products. Well, arguably, the CFC has benefited from U.S. intangibles, even though its profit margins may not have changed at all. But if it is lucky to earn excess income, you know, which is yet to be defined, but is commonly understood that it will be in excess over a relatively low base, you know, its profits could potentially be subject to this provision. And the third is that the excess income has to be subject to a low rate of tax, which is a sliding scale where 10% or below, it'll be 100% of the excess income, 15% of above, it'll be zero, and then the sliding scale in between. So at the Irish rate of 12.5%, you'd pick up half of that excess income. And I would just note that you know, under proposals, the US rate would go from 35% to say 28%. The difference between 28% and 15% is 13%, my math is right. And you may remember that when I started out with those original structures and I was talking about stripping from Ireland and from Switzerland, people were doing it to get a rate that was better than the Irish 12.5% rate, and the Swiss rate that was at 8 or 10%. I would submit that as long as you have the definition of low taxed being, or reasonably high taxed being 15% or above, people will still look for a way to arbitrage. They'll find a 15.1% rate, and they'll continue to engage in the arbitrage. So, you know, one of the questions I think that needs to be addressed here is whether this proposal is the right way to go about treating the problem here. So, really, two-stage question. First, is transfer pricing doomed? You know, can the IRS simply not enforce the arm's length standard in a way that protects the U.S. tax base? But then secondly, assume that you answer that question, yes, the IRS cannot protect the U.S. tax base. Is this the best approach, or, you know, is there another approach that would be preferable? And that's something that the four of us will debate later this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Let's now turn our focus to the economics, transfer pricing, and valuation implications in the context of outbound IP transfers, as well as cost-sharing arrangements that are used by multinational enterprises, particularly during the development phase. With that, we have two speakers for this segment, Stephen Blough and Charles Cope. Stephen Blough is a PhD economist and a principal with KPMG's Washington National Tax Practice and is the lead transfer pricing economist for some of the firm's largest clients and has extensive experience in intellectual property planning. Steve is a frequent speaker and an author on topics in this space. Charles Cope is an international tax principal with KPMG's Washington National Tax Practice. Prior to joining KPMG, Charles served as Associate International Tax Counsel at the Office of Tax Policy at the U.S. Treasury Department. Charles earned his tax LLM here from NYU, where he serves as a member of the Tax LLM Advisory Board. Stephen and Charles.
Thank you, Larry. Welcome, everybody. I'm Steve. This is Charles. Yeah,
hi.
I have a little bit of a heavy burden here. Not only, as far as I can tell, am I the only transfer pricing economist on the program, but I also have the particularly heavy burden, as we'll see, of defending the honor of my financial statement valuation colleagues. Give you an overview of the agenda. As you can see, we want to talk a little bit about definitions of intangibles. Obviously, we've heard quite a bit about definitions of intangibles heretofore. We're not going to repeat everything that you've already heard. We'll move briskly through that and highlight a few points that are relevant for our subsequent discussion. What we really want to focus on is the concept of goodwill and going concern value, and what I really want to focus on is definitions of goodwill and going concern value in the tax code. How does that line up with goodwill as an accounting concept? And what can we make of the differences? What are the economic sources of accounting goodwill? And how do they line up with the tax issues? And then go into the cost sharing, which has its own particular spin on these issues.
Yeah, and you know, what we, in terms of takeaways, what we want you to get out of this is how, in certain cases, how difficult it can be to accurately value certain intangible assets, and what the stakes are for taxpayers and the government in some of these disputes. So, with that, we will. I think you've already seen this definition earlier in the morning. There's a definition of intangible assets in the regulations under 42-4. It talks about patents, copyrights, trademarks, franchises, and other things. You might want to focus on number 4, franchises, licenses, or contracts. We'll talk about that a little bit later in more detail. And other similar items, you want to go to them. There's also a definition of intangible assets, or Section 197 intangible, in Section 197 that leads off with goodwill and going concern value, and then has a lot of the same items that are in the Dash 4 regs, 42-4. If you can go on to the next slide. And so one question you might have is, why are there different definitions? The definition 42 is rooted in section 936. Section 936 H3B was added to the code in 82. It was meant to address situations like the Eli Lilly case, in which Eli Lilly transferred intangible assets related to Darvon to a 936 company. There was tightening of 936 in 82. The government was concerned, Congress was concerned, that with the tightening, there'd be an incentive to transfer IP out of 936 companies to foreign corporations. And so there was 367D came in at the same time. On the other hand, and there was the policy concern was that the R&D costs of developing certain intangible assets are borne by the U.S. There's a deduction in the United States, but then if you transfer the IP offshore, that income can be deferred for a very long time, perhaps, and that, as a tax policy matter, the Congress didn't want that to continue. If we go to the next slide, 197 deals with a different question altogether. There was always an issue when a bundle of assets were acquired, not only to value them, but whether the acquired assets could be amortized or not, and whether there was a definite life to those assets. And 197 was meant to put an end to disputes between the government and taxpayers, particularly with respect to goodwill and going concern value. And so that's why the definition of 197 intangible leads off with references to goodwill and going concern value. So with that background in mind, the statutory background in mind, we're going to examine some of the issues that Steve talked about.
So I've been involved in any number of, has anybody, in the transfer pricing intangible valuation space in tax planning has, in any number of discussions over the years about, goodwill, how did you value the goodwill, what do you mean the goodwill is part of the intangible asset value? I talk to my valuation colleagues who look at me like I'm crazy, and I turn to my tax colleagues who refer to goodwill as something that sounds very different from what we're talking about when I'm talking to my valuation colleagues. And so in thinking about what would be useful to talk about today, I thought, well, maybe it would help to just spend some time looking at what these definitions are and do they actually have anything to do with each other. So digging first into the tax definitions, we have a specific definition of goodwill in the tax code in 197. Goodwill is the value of a trade or business attributable to the expectancy of continued customer patronage. This expectancy may be due to the name or reputation of a trade or business or any other factor. Now, that to me is a fairly specific definition and potentially a fairly narrow definition. It's value associated with an expectancy of future patronage. And I can think, as we'll talk about in a little bit, of a number of things that could end up as goodwill on a financial statement that have nothing to do with expectancy of future patronage. So that's interesting. We have a fairly narrow definition there. Then in 1060, we have a definition of going concern value. Going concern value is the additional value that attaches to property because of its existence as an integral part of an ongoing business activity, including the value of a trade or business to continue functioning and generating income without interruption, notwithstanding a change of ownership. I won't read the whole thing, but again, we have something a bit broader, a bit more vague, but maybe it does or does not necessarily, again, capture everything that goes into accounting goodwill. Finally, and importantly, we have, very importantly for the purposes that we're all talking about today, we have the 367A definition of foreign goodwill and going concern value, not discussing goodwill and going concern separately, but as a collective thing. Foreign goodwill or going concern value is the residual value of a business operation conducted outside the United States after all other tangible and intangible assets have been identified and valued. So we have the goodwill definition, which is quite specific, and we have the going concern value, which is a bit vague and may or may not capture a lot of things. Then we have the 367A definition of goodwill and going concern collectively, which is entirely a residual definition. It's what's left after we take everything else out. Now, what we can say, however, about the 367A definition is it somewhat begs the question of what constitutes the all other tangible, and specifically the all other intangible assets that get taken out first before you end up at goodwill and going concern value, and how are all that, and how is that all other valued? Okay. So that's, now we've established three definitions, a definition of goodwill and of going concern piecewise, and a definition of the collective under 367A. Well, what is goodwill and going concern, or rather, what is goodwill under accounting? Well, goodwill under accounting is and has always been purely a residual concept. And I actually drilled into, I read an accounting history of the concept of goodwill. And we have references going back to at least back to 1908, which describe goodwill as the value paid for a business over and above the sum of the value of the individual assets. And if you look at that literature, even back in 1908, it refers to that as arising from a complex variety of factors. So there's no attempt in the accounting literature to specify what goodwill comes from, or think about what that is, or how it arises. It is just that which is left over, and it is due to a complex variety of factors. Talking a little bit about the specific things that get removed in getting to that, so we have, unlike, you know, we have the 367A definition where we have maybe some ambiguity about what gets removed, there are, on the accounting side, very definite criteria for what can be valued and identified separately, those things that are subtracted before you get to the goodwill, which again is a residual. Trademark and trade, we have obviously tangible assets, things like cash, things like that. Trademark and trade name, customer relationships, which I will talk about in a minute, developed technology, fairly straightforward. In-process R&D, now in-process R&D has very specific recognition criteria, which will be important when we start thinking about valuing intangibles that are transferred and the IRS's position, especially under the cost-sharing regulations, of what constitutes a platform a platform contribution and how that relates to these concepts. I would note, by the way, with respect to the going concern value, that when my financial statement valuation colleagues value an asset, there's something called the premise of value that's used, whether it's liquidation value, et cetera, and in doing a purchase allocation as part of acquisition, they are always valued under the premise of being part of a going concern. So if you think back to that going concern value definition we had in the tax code, it's at least worth noting that when an intangible asset is valued for financial statement purposes, its value incorporates the fact that it's being used as part of a going concern. That's one of the assumptions that's being made. So if you think about the difference between that asset and liquidation value and that asset as part of a going concern, that difference is already built into the value of the asset before we even reach accounting goodwill. And then, of course, what really drives this, why is this a big issue? Well, it's a big issue because in the technology sector in particular, goodwill, and we'll see an example in a few minutes, goodwill is often more than 50% of the value of the asset value of an acquired company. So this is a big deal in terms of what is this, where does it come from, and is it getting transferred?
For financial accounting purposes.
Okay, so just a quick recap. Accounting goodwill is a purely residual concept. It also arises only in acquisitions. Okay, you can't have goodwill on the financial statement absent an acquisition. That's the only way it shows up. Goodwill and going concern under 367A, it's defined in 367A. It's obviously used or excluded under 367D, but it's defined in 367A. Again, a residual concept relatively close to the accounting concept. It's not restricted to acquisitions, but there is this question of, okay, well, for that purpose, how do we define the other intangibles? And then we have, as I talked about, these specific definitions of goodwill and going concern under 197 and 1060. And it seems that it's not at all clear how well aligned these are.
Okay.
You want to go, Charles?
Okay, so we've just finished talking about differences in definitions between accountants and tax advisors. Now we want to talk a little bit about what's at stake, and the stakes are, show up in a variety of different areas. One is under 367D. There's an exclusion in the regulations under 367D for transfers of foreign goodwill and going concern value. When Congress added 367D to the code, there's statements in the legislative history that, and actually in the law as well, in the statute itself, that it's okay for a U.S. company to transfer, incorporate a foreign branch outside the United States. And there's a particular carve-out in 367D for foreign goodwill and going concern value. And we'll see a little bit later on, we're going to discuss a particular case where the taxpayer and the government had an argument about whether something was foreign goodwill and going concern value or another intangible asset defined in Section 367 or 936. Another place where it has shown up over time where the definition is important is in the cost-sharing regulations. The cost-sharing regulations issued in 1995, which are no longer in effect, required a buy-in payment for any 42 intangibles that were made available under the terms of the cost-sharing arrangement. And the government argued in the Veritas case that the definition of intangible assets should be read broadly, and it also used valuation theories that would have swept in various assets, including the government argued that workforce in place was a valuable intangible that deserved compensation, and the tax court rejected that point of view. The government's position has changed under the final cost-sharing, the temporary and the final cost-sharing regulations. A platform contribution is what now requires compensation, and the concept of platform contribution has been broadened considerably to include more than just intangible assets. However, if you read the cost-sharing regulations closely, you'll see that goodwill and going concern value pretty much are excluded, although Steve will talk a little bit more about some subtleties. It's interesting to note that when the government argues that goodwill and going concern value is implicit in the Section 42 definition of intangibles, it really only appears, goodwill and going concern value, that term really only appears three times in the regulations. It doesn't appear at all under the Dash 4 regulations, which deal with transfers of intangibles, and it only showed up in the temporary and final cost-sharing regulations in three places. The last place where goodwill and going concern value tend to matter is when you're trying to value a U.S. company to determine whether it's a U.S. real property holding corporation or not. And there's language in the FRPTA regulations that strongly suggests that going concern value can be allocated to other assets on the company's balance sheet for purposes of calculating the FRPTA fraction. And so that's fairly interesting. It's something we often look out for. So what has the government done to try to give taxpayers some guidance in this area and help itself as well? We can go to the next slide. There has been a proposal in President Obama's budget for several years to clarify the definition of intangible asset for purposes of both Section 42 and 367D to include workforce in place and goodwill and going concern value. I have to say that when Tom Zollo read the proposal, he wasn't too happy about it, and he wrote an article, you can read it in Tax Management International Journal, where he disputed that the proposal was in fact a clarification of the law, and I recommend that article to you. But we're not going to discuss whether it's a clarification or not. The other thing to notice in this legislative proposal that we'll talk about, focus on a little bit later, is that there's also a move to clarify that where multiple intangible properties are transferred, it may be better to value them in aggregate. That, as we'll see, is a theme that is very useful in this area for, and maybe useful for the government, maybe useful for taxpayers, just depending on how the world works out. So with that, you know, one other thing I might mention is it's not entirely clear. We've never seen any statutory language and any effective dates. It's not entirely clear what the effect of this would be if it were enacted in the law. In the Veritas case, as I mentioned, workforce in place was a big deal, and the tax court judge rejected the government's argument. Would that have changed the outcome in Veritas? Is the government looking to change cases that it has in dispute right now under the 1995 regulations? So with that, we can go on.
Yeah, let me just make a couple quick remarks here. First, and we'll be talking a little bit more about the cost-sharing regulations and the examples there in a few minutes, but an interesting aspect of those examples, while people, I think, have the view that these cost-sharing regulations, you know, make goodwill and going concern taxable as part of a PCT, in the examples with the acquisition price method, they actually have a specific example where they are talking about the acquisition goodwill versus, you know, goodwill, and they actually say, well, in this particular case, there is a bunch of tax goodwill and going concern value that shouldn't be taxed.
Right.
So there seems to be almost a commitment to make sure everybody is completely confused about what definition of goodwill and going concern value is being used for what purpose. Okay, so I think, you know, I want to get to these issues again about what is the IRS, what is the government concerned about here in intangible valuation, and what are these relationships among goodwill of different types. I think it would be helpful to think, I find it helpful to think about, you know, in the context of an acquisition, what are some of the, and I use a broad term, what are some of the economic phenomena, what are some of the aspects of a business that could result in there being significant goodwill on the balance sheet as in the purchase allocation of that business. And because then once we have that broken down, we can think a little bit about, okay, well, what are these things, you know, arguably might want to be considered as something that we want to have as a taxable transaction. What is true goodwill? But let's at least think about what some of these are. And for some of them, we in fact have some, at least a little bit of court case and some history on them. So I'll just start with the expectancy of future patronage. Now, I think it's worth noting with respect to this sort of classic tax definition of goodwill, of expectancy of future patronage, that in purchase allocation valuation for financial statement purposes, there is something called customer relationship value, which is a separately valued asset that's not part of goodwill. And I'm not going to bore everyone but myself and a couple of valuation folks in the room with a discussion of exactly how they go about valuing customer relationships, but I will represent to you that if you look at how customer relationships are valued for financial statement purposes, it seems to have an awful lot of an aspect of expectancy of continued patronage built into it. And so I could at least raise the question of, well, you know, is there tax goodwill under the 197 definition of goodwill that's actually showing up in that customer relationship value that is not in...
Based on what you've told me, Steve, I believe it is.
Well, and in fact, we've had discussions here that if you're transferring customer relationship value, can you use, you know, do you need to use the full financial statement value of it? And because that value goes way above and beyond anything that is based on any kind of a contract or legal obligation, I think there's a good argument that there is, in fact, goodwill built into that. And if you're transferring customer relationships, that under that standard, you wouldn't pay for the goodwill aspect of that customer relationship value.
Yeah.
So that's number one. But there could be some of that that's actually in the accounting goodwill. Secondly, I'm now going to give the economic phenomena that I think is probably the most IRS favorable, at least the most of what the IRS has in mind when they're talking about this, which is expectation of continued success of intangible development program beyond the IP R&D recognition criteria. So if you are acquiring a company, if there's a company acquired, it's a technology company, and this is actually one of the IRS's examples in the cost-sharing regulations, it hasn't gone live yet, it has no revenues, it's got a few patents, it's got some stuff that they're working on, and it's got an R&D workforce, and the acquisition is, say, for $100 million, and you end up with, say, you know, $10 million of developed technology and a few million dollars of IP R&D and $80 million of goodwill, probably that goodwill is coming from some sort of expectancy that there's going to be future development of this stuff, and that is in some way attached to the intellectual property that they're developing or have in progress, or to the research team that you have somehow, a special research team that's going to be hard to recreate, and that is why this price is being paid for the acquisition. So clearly, now if you look into how intangible assets are valued for goodwill, for financial statement purposes, there are recognition criteria there. Something needs to be separable and separably transferable. If I'm paying for a company based purely on an expectation that they're going to be able to develop something good, regardless of how well-defined that is at this point, that might very well end up as goodwill on the balance sheet in the purchase allocation rather than as a value of an intangible asset or IP R&D. So clearly, conceptually, this is something that could affect the purchase price, and it could end up as goodwill in a purchase allocation. Now, a third thing could be network intangibles. We're going to talk a little, Charles is going to talk a little bit more about network intangibles in a minute, but you could have a very valuable network of delivery agents in a case like, in, say, a package delivery service, or you could have a network of doctors for a healthcare service. You could have some sort of a network that may or may not be valuable and may or may not be separable, but that could certainly add to value, but not be something that would end up being valued as a separate asset for financial statement purposes and thus end up in goodwill. Finally, there are a host of things that come under what I will call synergy effects. That is, I have a business that is going to be unique, an existing business that is going to be uniquely able to benefit from something that the company I'm going to acquire has. Whether that because I'm taking something out of the competition, it's something that really helps me develop something that I'm going forward with. It's going to drive new sales of my existing products through the acquired company's network or vice versa. A host of things that are synergies that are just, I refer to this as the problem that accounting is additive and economics is often multiplicative. So things that are not easily separable in terms of what is due to the acquired company and what is due to the acquiring company, there are synergies between the two. And those types of values often will end up as goodwill on the balance sheet. And whether they end up as something that someone wants to tax or not is a really interesting question.
Right. Yeah, these definitions can actually, they may be sources of economic goodwill, but they also may be, in the view of the government or a taxpayer, depending upon the facts, they may actually be intangibles that you want to recognize.
They might be intangibles you want to recognize. They might be things that we really think are goodwill. They might be things that we think are already offshore because it synergies with something that I've got with my offshore, my right. existing offshore business already, which is a very important, very important circumstance. Just as an example of this, just to show how powerful, how important this is, we looked up the purchase allocation when Google acquired YouTube. So Google acquired YouTube for $1.2 billion, and there was, of course, a purchase allocation done of that $1.2 billion. Well, of that $1.2 billion, a billion of it was goodwill for purchase allocation purposes. Now, was that expectation of continued customer patronage of YouTube's videos? Was it the fact that the assets are assembled into an ongoing business and not separate? Or was it something, you know, or was it synergies with what Google is already doing? Is it because they really like YouTube's customers or vice versa? There are a lot of, and there are a whole bunch of possible explanations for why Google paid $1 billion for YouTube. And understanding the economics of that, I think, is vital to understanding, you know, and how much of that was due to what Google already had offshore, what YouTube already had offshore versus onshore. very difficult, very complicated, but vital to understanding what we think is going on here economically and what might be being transferred between related parties. If Google, I think, if Google has some sort of an intangible structure, they're going to be moving these things into.
Yeah, so I mean, that, big that, dollars that is associated that, in real life, that's actually a very big deal.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about that in a little bit more detail. Yeah. Okay, now we're going to talk about another real life example where the definition of foreign goodwill and going concern value mattered quite a bit to a particular taxpayer. I don't think anybody's written on this, but you can sort of piece together the facts by reading a 2009 TAM and then also looking at court documents you can sort of figure out that from the court documents that the 2009 TAM refers to the first data case that was settled late last year. And first data involved the involved a foreign business, foreign branch that was conducted by First Data. It was their money transfer business that they established. They grew it in the 80s and 90s. They operated out of Paris. Their money transfer business globally, I think, accounted for $3 or $4 billion of revenue for First Data. And in 2003, First Data transferred that business to a CFC in a 351 transaction qualified under Section 367. And it argued that a lot of the value that was transferred was excluded from Section 367D, current tax under 367D, because it was foreign goodwill and going concern value. Specifically, what was transferred, there was some computer software that was transferred. There were some CFCs that were transferred. But there was also a group of contracts with foreign agents that, independent foreign agents, that facilitated the development, the delivery of money transfers outside the United States. 122,000, and First Data filed a tax return that valued those contracts, I think, at about $14 million, and valued the balance of this foreign business at I think, several billion dollars. There were some other assets that were transferred as well, as I said. So it wasn't all foreign goodwill and going concern value. The IRS examined the return and came back with a valuation for the contracts with the independent foreign agents of about $2.7 billion. So there was a little disagreement as to how much the contracts were worth. The taxpayer filed a petition in the tax court, which is why we know something about what the gist of the argument is, as well as the TAM. And then the TAM goes into a great deal of detail. It's a 2009 TAM that goes into a great deal of detail about what the party's arguments were. First Data said that you should value these contracts with the independent foreign agents individually. You should not value them as a group. And it argued that the residual value of the business was foreign goodwill and going concern value. And to support that argument, First Data referred to the government's position in some cases that were pre-Section 197. Well, pre-Section 197, the government was very keen to argue that a lot of the value of a bundle of business assets was attributable to goodwill and going concern value, because that didn't have a definite life and it wasn't amortizable. So First Data was using the government's old cases against it. The government, on the other hand, responded, well, number one, if you look at the definition of intangible asset in 367D, which is what 936 references, it refers to contracts, and you have contracts here. It also refers to franchises. You could think of this foreign business as a franchise. And it refers to systems and similar items like that. And any of those could be viewed as intangible assets that were subject to valuation and are subject to tax under 367D. The government went on to argue, referring to the regulations under 482, that you have to consider what is the most accurate way of valuing these groups of contracts. Mm-hmm. And the government argued that they should be valued in the aggregate. And if you value them in the aggregate, then rather than valuing them individually, that's where their true value was in the aggregate. And that's how the government came up with the multi-billion dollar value for the contracts. It also, it somewhat humorously, the TAM says, the taxpayer is referring to that old definition of goodwill and going concern value, not the new modern definition that's in the 367D regulations, which, you know, honestly, I mean, the IRS wrote regulations and it defined foreign goodwill and going concern value. But it does show you how, over time, people's positions on this issue have changed. So what happened? Well, the taxpayer and the government didn't go to trial. They settled in December of last year, and we know because there was a stipulation filed. I believe that the numbers are on the slide. They valued the network at $737 million. Mm-hmm. And the agreed income adjustments were $15.4 million for 2003 and $70 million for 2004. And I assume the rest of that $737 million is going to be picked up under Section 367D over a period of time. Now, you might ask, how did they get from the $2 billion number to the $737 right. number? My guess is that they put a life on those intangible assets. They agreed that that network didn't last forever, mm-hmm. And that's what reduced the value of the network.
Right. So Charles, just in the transfer pricing world, the concept of network intangibles gets kicked around fairly often.
Right.
Do you think this general sort of identifying as an intangible applies generally, or can you summarize what the specific facts were here that were in the IRS's favor in terms of this? Getting first data to stipulate to this.
Well, I think 367D has a heavy transfer pricing component to it. Mm-hmm. And I think the government was helped by its regulations that allowed aggregate valuation, mm-hmm. and they'll be further helped by that proposed right. legislation. I would note, neither party wanted to go to trial on this. Mm-hmm. So neither party was sure mm-hmm. enough as to where this would come out, so we don't really know what the courts would say, and the Obama administration hasn't proposed any legislation that would deal with this.
All right. So let's start talking about the cost sharing regulations specifically. The cost sharing regulations say that PCT value must reflect all rights, resources, and capabilities made available by the PCT payee, and the government is extremely clear and vocal about the fact that they included this clause very intentionally to pick up a much broader concept of intangibles. And I believe I've been in meetings where they say, yes, we absolutely intend this to be a broader concept of intangibles, and it's in 936 or in the regulations. This rights, resources, and capabilities is supposed to be extremely broad intentionally. They also include the statement that financial statement valuation may be a useful starting point but not dispositive for valuing intangible assets. Now, here's where I said at the beginning that I was here in part to defend the honor of my financial statement valuation colleagues, and this is where I'm going to do that. They included a statement that I would refer to as an overly contentious statement, particularly where the accounting treatment of an asset is inconsistent with its economic value. Now, I don't know if anybody has really gone to my senior valuation folks and told them that the IRS is saying this about them, but I strongly suspect that they would adamantly dispute the idea that when an asset is valued for financial statement purposes, that the accounting treatment is ever inconsistent with its economic value. What I think would be a very fair statement, again, is that when assets are being valued for financial statement purposes, there are very clear definitions and very clear recognition criteria for valuing that asset. And they accurately value that asset under the definitions that they use under their standards for very, very good reasons. And the issue is not whether the economic value is the same as the accounting treatment of the asset. It's whether the accounting definition of the asset picks up everything that the IRS would like it pick up. And there, the answer is clearly no. And you know, this expectation of future development and the more generally the concepts of platform rights, I think, are part of that. Now, it's easiest, I think, to talk about where these things intersect in the context of the acquisition price method, which is one of the new methods in the cost-sharing regulations that was never in, it was not in Dash 4 methods for value intangible assets. The IRS started using it as an unspecified method quite some time ago and first introduced it as a specified method, first in the proposed and then in the temporary and final cost-sharing regulations. Now, what the acquisition price method does is it confronts this issue of what happens with accounting goodwill head on. It says the starting point, if you acquire a company and then transfer intangibles owned by the acquired company out of the US, if it's a US acquired company, we transfer the intangibles owned by that out of the US, the starting point for that valuation is the total purchase consideration grossed up for any liabilities acquired, so the total acquired value of the assets. And then the valuation for cost-sharing purposes proceeds by subtracting anything that we can specifically value that is not being transferred offshore. And therefore, in effect, it comes to the, essentially the opposite conclusion of purchase price allocation, where residual, and for that matter, from 367A definition, rather than saying anything that we can't specifically value is goodwill, the acquisition price method says anything we can't specifically value is part of the intangible assets being transferred. And so there is obviously, and this is the language I think then starts getting everybody confused, but implicitly accounting goodwill is now being allocated and it's made part of the intangible assets being transferred. And the theme of the earlier discussion about definitions was, you know, that may or may not be the same as saying goodwill as defined under 197 or under 367 is being included in the transfer is a much more, I would say, at least ambiguous topic because these definitions are not, in my mind, in any way entirely consistent with each other. Mm-hmm. Now, the regs include two examples for the acquisition price method that I think bear considerable study because they say a number of interesting things about this. The first example was an example I alluded to back when I was talking about expectation of future development. The example is one where the U.S. parent acquires a U.S. Company. It is not operational yet. It has no sales. It has an assembled workforce of an R&D team. It has some patents and some developed technology and some in-process R&D. And that's basically all it has. And then the foreign rights to the use of this technology and subsequent technology is transferred as part of a Dash 7 transaction to a foreign party. And the example says, in this case, the acquisition goodwill is essentially all attributable to this technology, and it all goes into the value. There's nothing carved out. But the IRS also has a second example here. And I think the second example is very important to pay attention to because I think it is widely applicable and probably not considered enough, including by potentially IRS examiners. The second example is where the acquired company is live, it does have revenues, it does have foreign operations, and therefore in analyzing it, the regulations specifically say, and this is interesting when it goes back to this idea of making goodwill taxable, is it says, in this case, a significant part of the accounting goodwill is in fact attributable to goodwill and going concern value. is associated with the offshore operations of this acquired company, and therefore does not need to be incorporated into the value of the intangibles for transfer. So what's interesting here, first of all, they make this, they clearly recognize that if you've got anything other than this sort of simple example one case where there's nothing else going on and nothing going on outside of the United States, they recognize, first of all, that the reliability of the acquisition price method is immediately called into question. Mm-hmm. And secondly, they explicitly state that goodwill and that some of the accounting goodwill could be true goodwill and going concern value and therefore not taxable, or at least does not need to be paid for as part of that transfer.
Right.
So any other comments on that one, Charles?
No, before? I think I want to go on to the
income method. Okay, so income method. Now, in the income method, there is no such thing as accounting goodwill because we don't have an acquisition, and accounting goodwill only arises as an acquisition. Nonetheless, we can think of what I would call implied goodwill as it would arise, for example, if you took the 367 definition of foreign goodwill and going concern value. Assume that when it says taking out other assets, you're taking out the other assets that would be valued for financial statement purposes. And so there's implied goodwill under the income method, which is simply the present value of all of the income you expect to receive in the foreign operation, less whatever it would be under accounting criteria would be identified with the specific assets that are being transferred.
For those of you who have not studied the income method in detail, you might ask yourself, well, why would a platform contribution be measured by the value of the asset that the platform contribution actually leads to? And the answer is because it's very difficult to value the platform contribution, and so you start by the assumption that the value of the new intangible is the value of the platform contribution, and then you start lopping off things that that belong to something else, right, and at the end of the day, you're left with the platform contribution.
Right. Yep, and that's exactly so. So the income method is really the same, essentially the economic equivalent of the acquisition price method, but applied to the case where there's a transfer happening that was not something that was recently acquired. Now, and again, the income method, like the acquisition price method, defaults to assigning all of this, what I would refer to as implied goodwill, to the PCT. And this is directly analogous to the position the IRS took and lost on in the Veritas case, which took the transfer as being akin to a sale of a business. The position under the income method is you are, in effect, transferring all of the rights associated with this future income stream to the foreign participant. You're basically transferring this business, and we're going to value this as if we were valuing a business that had this income stream.
Yeah, I mean, I don't, I might dispute that. I'm not sure you're being entirely fair to the government. I mean, given the examples in the acquisition price method, I think the government has said that you should not be including at least the foreign goodwill and going concern value when you're valuing the PCT payment. And you know, the government could also say, well, look, this is a hard thing to value. We have a best method rule. The income method may not always be the best method. You know, you might have a cut or a poor cut, a comparable uncontrolled transaction that you can use for valuing the platform contributions.
Well, that's exactly right, Charles. And the point here is, again, in thinking about the income method, I hear the reaction a lot that, well, if I'm under the cost-sharing regulations, that means I have to use the income method. And I think that that is moving much too rapidly. Again, if you've got developed foreign operations, the income method, you need to look at the rights, resources, and capabilities of all parties to the transaction. And if you have a well-developed foreign operation and you are transferring these intangibles, to be used by that foreign operation, they may very well bring rights, resources, and capabilities, to the business. They may not be 936 intangibles, but they may very well be rights, resources, and capabilities that are being brought. that need to be valued under the regs as part of the transaction.
Right.
And that could be handled in a variety of different ways, either by looking at it as both parties making a PCT, or even on the income method by thinking carefully about how you were going to look at the reasonable alternative, as it's called, and how much profit they would make absent this. And so, again, I think the income method, again, is under the regs as something that, if you look closely, is acknowledged in the regulations as being applicable to a specific fact situation where there is relatively little being brought to the table by the foreign operation. And if that's not the case, you may very well be out of the income method entirely and into the residual profit method or some other method, or at least in a situation where you can put a lot of thought into how you build your income method valuation.
Yeah. So, in order to, summarize where we are, we started out by saying we wanted to let you know that definitions do matter, and sometimes intangible assets are extremely difficult to value. And I think we've demonstrated that in the last 45 minutes. The taxpayers, tax advisors, accountants, and economists seem to have different definitions, which makes it difficult for them to get in the same room and talk to each other. And also, the stakes may vary between the government and the taxpayer depending upon whether you're in the cost-sharing regulations, whether you're in FERPTA, or whether you're trying to do an outbound transfer of assets under Section 367D. And I think this area is a moving target. I think there's going to continue to be litigation in this area, not only under the old cost-sharing regulations, but perhaps under 367D. And there's probably going to be legislation in this area as well. So stay tuned, and we might have a different panel on this 5 years from now.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Charles and Steve. The next, of course, will be lunch.